Welcome to the transformative journey within the pages of As a Man Thinketh by James Allen. In this audiobook, we will explore each section, uncovering the profound meaning behind the text, and offering practical insights in simpler language. Let the wisdom of James Allen empower you to shape your life and become the best version of yourself. I will first read out a section or chapter of the book, followed by an enlightening explanation to deepen our understanding. Thought and character. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Not only embraces the whole of a man's being, but is so comprehensive as to reach out to every condition and circumstance of his life. A man is literally what he thinks, his character being the complete sum of all his thoughts. As the plant springs from, and could not be without, the seed, so every act of man springs from the hidden seeds of thought, and could not have appeared without them. This applies equally to those acts called spontaneous and unpremeditated, as to those which are deliberately executed. Act is the blossom of thought, and joy and suffering are its fruit. Thus does a man garner in the sweet and bitter fruitage of his own husbandry. Thought in the mind hath made us. What we are by though is wrought and built. If a man's mind hath evil thought, pain comes on him as comes the wheel the ox behind. If one endure in purity of thought, joy follows him as his own shadow sure. The first paragraph from the book is quite profound, so let's break it down and explore its meaning in a simpler language. The paragraph begins with the statement, "As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he." This means that a person's thoughts have a significant impact on their entire being, encompassing their character, actions, and circumstances. In other words, the quality of our thoughts shapes who we are as individuals. Just as a plant grows from a seed and cannot exist without it, every action a person takes is rooted in their thoughts. This applies to both spontaneous actions and deliberate ones. Our thoughts are like the seeds from which our actions grow. The paragraph continues by saying that our actions are the blossoms of our thoughts, and the joy or suffering we experience are the fruits of those actions. It means that the outcome of our thoughts and actions determines the happiness or pain we encounter in life. Just as a farmer harvests the sweet and bitter fruits of their labor, we gather the consequences of our thoughts and actions. The paragraph concludes by highlighting the power of thought. It states that our thoughts shape us and build our identity. If our minds are filled with negative or evil thoughts, we will attract pain and suffering. On the other hand, if we maintain purity of thought, joy will follow us like a faithful shadow. The overall message is that our thoughts have tremendous influence on who we become and the experiences we have. By cultivating positive and pure thoughts, we can create a path towards joy and fulfillment in our lives. Conversely, dwelling on negative thoughts can lead to pain and suffering. Let's read further. Man is a growth by law, and not a creation by artifice, and cause and effect are as absolute and undeviating in the hidden realm of thought as in the world of visible and material things. A noble and godlike character is not a thing of favor or chance, but is the natural result of continued effort in right thinking, the effect of long-cherished association with godlike thoughts. An ignoble and bestial character, by the same process, is the result of the continued harboring of groveling thoughts. Man is made or unmade by himself. In the armory of thought he forges the weapons by which he destroys himself. He also fashions the tools with which he builds for himself heavenly mansions of joy and strength and peace. By the right choice and true application of thought, man ascends to the divine perfection. By the abuse and wrong application of thought he descends below the level of the beast. Between these two extremes are all the grades of character, and man is their maker and master. Of all the beautiful truths pertaining to the soul which have been restored and brought to light in this age, none is more gladdening or fruitful of divine promise and confidence than this, that man is the master of thought, the molder of character, and the maker and shaper of condition, environment, and destiny. As a being of power, intelligence, and love, and the lord of his own thoughts, man holds the key to every situation, and contains within himself that transforming and regenerative agency by which he may make himself what he wills. Man is always the master, even in his weakest and most abandoned state. But in his weakness and degradation, he is foolish master who misgoverns his household. When he begins to reflect upon his condition and search diligently for the law upon which his being is established, he then becomes the wise master, directing his energies with intelligence and fashioning his thoughts to fruitful issues. Such is the conscious master, and man can only thus become by discovering within himself the laws of thought. This discovery is totally a matter of application, self-analysis, and experience. Only by much searching and mining are gold and diamonds obtained, and man can find every truth connected with his being, if he will dig deep into the mine of his soul. That he is the maker of his character, the molder of his life, and the builder of his destiny, he may unerringly prove, if he will watch, control, and alter his thoughts, tracing their effects upon himself, upon others, and upon his life and circumstances, linking cause and effect by patient practice and investigation. And utilizing his every experience, even the most trivial, everyday occurrence, as a means of obtaining that knowledge of himself which is understanding, wisdom, power. In this direction, as in no other, is the law absolute that he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. For only by patience, practice, and ceaseless importunity can a man enter the door of the temple of knowledge. Okay. Let's break it down and go over in an in-depth explanation of this section. This section explores the idea that our thoughts have a strong influence on our lives. It suggests that the way we think about ourselves and the world around us shapes who we become. It explains that our thoughts are not just random, but they follow a natural law of cause and effect. This means that our thoughts have consequences, just like actions do. It emphasizes that our character, which is who we are as a person, is formed by our thoughts. If we think positively and have noble thoughts, we tend to develop a good character. On the other hand, if we have negative and lowly thoughts, our character suffers. This section also highlights that we have control over our own destinies. It states that we have the power to shape our lives based on the thoughts we choose to focus on. By thinking positively and constructively, we can create a better life for ourselves. It further explains that we are responsible for our own thoughts and actions. We have the ability to build ourselves up or tear ourselves down through the choices we make in our thoughts. This means that we have the power to change and improve our lives by changing our thinking patterns. Each person has the potential for growth and transformation. It suggests that by tapping into our inner strength, intelligence, and love, we can overcome challenges and create a fulfilling life. That we hold the key to our own success and happiness. It also encourages self-reflection and self-analysis as important tools for personal growth. By looking deep within ourselves, we can gain a better understanding of our thoughts and their effects on our lives. This self-awareness helps us make better choices and learn from our experiences. Lastly, this section highlights the importance of continuous learning and seeking knowledge. It suggests that by being curious, persistent, and open-minded, we can unlock the wisdom and understanding that will guide us on our journey of self-discovery. In summary, our thoughts have a significant impact on our lives. By cultivating positive thoughts, taking responsibility for our actions, and continuously seeking personal growth, we can shape our character, create a fulfilling life, and reach our full potential. Let's continue. Effect of thought on circumstances. A man's mind may be likened to a garden, which may be intelligently cultivated or allowed to run wild, but whether cultivated or neglected, it must and will bring forth. If no useful seeds are put into it, then an abundance of useless weed seeds will fall therein, and will continue to produce their kind. Just as a gardener cultivates his plot, keeping it free from weeds, and growing the flowers and fruits which he requires, so may a man tend the garden of his mind, weeding out all the wrong, useless, and impure thoughts, and cultivating toward perfection the flowers and fruits of right, useful, and pure thoughts. By pursuing this process, a man sooner or later discovers that he is the master, gardener of his soul, the director of his life. He also reveals, within himself, the flaws of thought, and understands, with ever-increasing accuracy, how the thought forces and mind elements operate in the shaping of character, circumstances, and destiny. Thought and character are one, and as character can only manifest and discover itself through environment and circumstance, the outer conditions of a person's life will always be found to be harmoniously related to his inner state. This does not mean that a man's circumstances at any given time are an indication of his entire character, but that those circumstances are so intimately connected with some vital thought element within himself that, for the time being, they are indispensable to his development. Every man is where he is by the law of his being. The thoughts which he has built into his character have brought him there, and in the arrangement of his life there is no element of chance, but all is the result of a law which cannot err. This is just as true of those who feel out of harmony with their surroundings as of those who are contented with them. We'll pause right there. Let's go over it. This section compares a person's mind to a garden that can be either well cultivated or left untended. Just as a gardener takes care of their garden by removing weeds and growing desired plants, a person can take charge of their mind by replacing negative and impure thoughts with positive and pure ones. By consciously shaping their thoughts, a person becomes the master gardener of their own mind and the director of their life. It highlights the interconnectedness of thought, character, and circumstances. Our thoughts shape our character, and our character is reflected in the circumstances and events of our lives. While our current circumstances may not define our entire character, they are closely linked to the dominant thoughts and beliefs within us. Our thoughts create the foundation upon which our life experiences are built. This section also emphasizes the law of cause and effect, stating that every person is where they are in life because of the thoughts they have cultivated. There are no coincidences or random events. Everything is governed by a law that never fails. This applies to both those who feel dissatisfied with their circumstances and those who are content with them. Our thoughts have brought us to our current situation, and they continue to shape our future experiences. In summary, our thoughts have a profound influence on our character and the circumstances we encounter. By cultivating positive thoughts and aligning them with our desired outcomes, we can transform our lives and create harmony between our inner state and outer conditions. We have the power to shape our destiny through the deliberate and conscious direction of our thoughts. Let's continue. As a progressive and evolving being, man is where he is that he may learn that he may grow, and as he learns the spiritual lesson which any circumstance contains for him, it passes away and gives place to other circumstances. Man is buffeted by circumstances so long as he believes himself to be the creature of outside conditions, but when he realizes that he is a creative power, and that he may command the hidden soil and seeds of his being out of which circumstances grow, he then becomes the rightful master of himself. That circumstances grow out of thought every man knows who has for any length of time practiced self-control and self-purification. For he will have noticed that the alteration in his circumstances has been in exact ratio with his altered mental condition. So true is this that when a man earnestly applies himself to remedy the defects in his character, and makes swift and marked progress, he passes rapidly through a succession of vicissitudes. The soul attracts that which it secretly harbors, that which it loves, and also that which it fears. It reaches the height of its cherished aspirations. It falls to the level of its unchastened desires, and circumstances are the means by which the soul receives its own. Every thought seed sown or allowed to fall into the mind, and to take root there, produces its own, blossoming sooner or later into act, and bearing its own fruitage of opportunity and circumstance. Good thoughts bear good fruit, bad thoughts bad fruit. The outer world of circumstances shapes itself to the inner world of thought, and both pleasant and unpleasant external conditions are factors which make for the ultimate good of the individual. As the reaper of his own harvest, man learns both of suffering and bliss. Following the inmost desires, aspirations, thoughts, by which he allows himself to be dominated, pursuing the will-o'-the-wisps of impure imaginings, or steadfastly walking the highway of strong and high endeavor, a man at last arrives at their fruition and fulfillment in the outer conditions of his life. This section delves into the profound connection between an individual's thoughts and the circumstances they experience. Let's explore its meaning in depth. It suggests that human beings are not mere passive recipients of circumstances, but active creators of their own reality. The analogy of a garden is used to illustrate this concept. Just as a gardener cultivates a garden by removing weeds and nurturing desirable plants, individuals have the power to tend to the garden of their minds. By eliminating negative and impure thoughts and nurturing positive and pure thoughts, they can shape their character and consequently influence the conditions and events they encounter in life. The section emphasizes that the relationship between thoughts and circumstances is not arbitrary but governed by a precise law. It states that a person's current circumstances are the direct result of the thoughts they have consistently entertained. Whether someone finds themselves in harmonious or discordant circumstances, it is not a matter of chance or luck, but rather the inevitable consequence of the thoughts they have cultivated. Moreover, it asserts that as individuals gain a deeper understanding of this principle, they can consciously harness the power of their thoughts to transform their lives. By recognizing that their thoughts are creative forces, they can become intentional architects of their destiny. Through self-control, self-purification, and a dedicated pursuit of higher ideals, individuals can alter their mental condition and witness corresponding changes in their external circumstances. The section also highlights the intimate connection between desires, aspirations, and thoughts. It suggests that individuals attract experiences and conditions that align with their dominant thoughts and emotions. Positive and constructive thoughts lead to favorable outcomes, while negative and destructive thoughts result in undesirable consequences. Furthermore, the section acknowledges that the external world is a reflection of an individual's inner state. It suggests that external circumstances are neither punishments nor rewards but serve as mirrors, reflecting the inner landscape of thoughts and beliefs. Both pleasurable and challenging circumstances offer opportunities for growth, learning, and self-discovery. In summary, this section underscores the profound influence of thoughts on an individual's character, circumstances, and destiny. It emphasizes the power of self-awareness, self-mastery, and conscious thinking in shaping one's reality. By cultivating positive and constructive thoughts, individuals can harmonize their inner and outer worlds, manifest their aspirations, and ultimately live a fulfilling and purposeful life. Let's continue. The laws of growth and adjustment everywhere obtain. A man does not come to the almshouse or the jail by the tyranny of fate or circumstance, but by the pathway of groveling thoughts and base desires. Nor does a pure-minded man fall suddenly into crime by stress of any mere external force. The criminal thought had long been secretly fostered in the heart, and the hour of opportunity revealed its gathered power. Circumstance does not make the man, it reveals him to himself. No such conditions can exist as descending into vice and its attendant sufferings apart from vicious inclinations, or ascending into virtue and its pure happiness without the continued cultivation of virtuous aspirations. And man, therefore, as the lord and master of thought, is the maker of himself and the shaper of and author of environment. Even at birth the soul comes of its own, and through every step of its earthly pilgrimage it attracts those combinations of conditions which reveal itself, which are the reflections of its own purity and impurity, its strength and weakness. Men do not attract that which they want, but that which they are. Their whims, fancies, and ambitions are thwarted at every step, but their inmost thoughts and desires are fed with their own food, be it foul or clean. Man is manacled only by himself. Thought and action are the jailers of fate they imprison, being base. They are also the angels of freedom they liberate, being noble. Not what he wished and prays for does a man get, but what he justly earns. His wishes and prayers are only gratified and answered when they harmonize with his thoughts and actions. In the light of this truth, what, then, is the meaning of fighting against circumstances? It means that a man is continually revolting against an effect without, while all the time he is nourishing and preserving its cause in his heart. That cause may take the form of a conscious vice or an unconscious weakness, but whatever it is, it stubbornly retards the efforts of its possessor, and thus calls aloud for remedy. Men are anxious to improve their circumstances, but are unwilling to improve themselves. They therefore remain bound. The man who does not shrink from self-crucifixion can never fail to accomplish the object upon which his heart is set. This is as true of earthly as of heavenly things. Even the man whose sole object is to acquire wealth must be prepared to make great personal sacrifices before he can accomplish his object, and how much more so he who would realize a strong and well-poised life. Okay, let's pause and go over it. In this section, we delve into the profound influence of thoughts on an individual's circumstances and ultimate destiny. It asserts that individuals are not victims of fate or circumstance, but creators of their own reality. It emphasizes that neither poverty nor imprisonment is a result of external forces, but rather a manifestation of groveling thoughts and base desires. Similarly, a person of pure mind does not suddenly fall into crime due to external pressure. The seeds of criminal thoughts were silently nurtured within the heart, and when the opportune moment arises, they reveal their accumulated power. Circumstances merely serve as a mirror, reflecting an individual's true self. It highlights that individuals cannot attract what they merely wish for, but rather what they truly are. Whims, fancies, and ambitions are often frustrated, while deep-rooted thoughts and desires find resonance in the external world. Man is bound only by his own thoughts and actions. Base thoughts and actions imprison him, while noble thoughts and actions set him free. This section reveals that individuals do not receive what they wish and pray for unless their thoughts and actions align with their desires. It questions the notion of fighting against circumstances, explaining that it signifies a continual rebellion against external effects while nourishing the very causes within one's heart. Whether conscious vices or unconscious weaknesses, these causes hinder progress and demand resolution. It addresses the tendency of individuals to desire improved circumstances without being willing to improve themselves. As a result, they remain bound by their own limitations. However, the section highlights that those who are unafraid of self-transformation can accomplish their heart's desires. This applies not only to material aspirations but also to the pursuit of a well-balanced and fulfilling life. The section concludes by highlighting that even the pursuit of wealth requires personal sacrifices. Likewise, the attainment of a strong and harmonious life demands inner growth and self-discipline. It emphasizes that individuals must be prepared to undergo self-crucifixion, shedding their old limiting beliefs and behaviors, in order to achieve their deepest aspirations. In summary, it underscores the power of thoughts and actions in shaping an individual's circumstances and ultimate destiny. It emphasizes the need for inner transformation and self-improvement as the key to unlocking one's true potential. By aligning thoughts and actions with noble aspirations, individuals can break free from self-imposed limitations and manifest a life of purpose, fulfillment, and success. Let's continue. Here is a man who is wretchedly poor. He is extremely anxious that his surroundings and home comforts should improve, yet all the time he shirks his work and considers he is justified in trying to deceive his employer on the ground of the insufficiency of his wages. Such a man does not understand the simplest rudiments of those principles which are the basis of true prosperity, and is not only totally unfitted to rise out of his wretchedness, but is actually attracting to himself a still deeper wretchedness by dwelling in and acting out indolent, deceptive, and unmanly thoughts. Here is a rich man who is the victim of a painful and persistent disease as the result of gluttony. He is willing to give large sums of money to get rid of it, but he will not sacrifice his gluttonous desires. He wants to gratify his taste for rich and unnatural foods and have his health as well. Such a man is totally unfit to have health, because he has not yet learned the first principles of a healthy life. Here is an employer of labor who adopts crooked measures to avoid paying the regulation wage, and in the hope of making larger profits, reduces the wages of his workpeople. Such a man is altogether unfitted for prosperity. And when he finds himself bankrupt, both as regards reputation and riches, he blames circumstances, not knowing that he is the sole author of his condition. I have introduced these three cases merely as illustrative of the truth that man is the causer, though nearly always unconsciously, of his circumstances, and that, whilst aiming at the good end, he is continually frustrating its accomplishment by encouraging thoughts and desires which cannot possibly harmonize with that end. Such cases could be multiplied and varied almost indefinitely, but this is not necessary. The reader can, if he so resolves, trace the action of the laws of thought in his own mind and life, and until this is done, mere external facts cannot serve as a ground of reasoning. Circumstances, however, are so complicated, thought is so deeply rooted, and the conditions of happiness vary so vastly with individuals, that a man's entire soul condition, although it may be known to himself, cannot be judged by another from the external aspect of his life alone. A man may be honest in certain directions, yet suffer privations. A man may be dishonest in certain directions, yet acquire wealth. But the conclusion usually formed that the one man fails because of his particular honesty, and that the other prospers because of his particular dishonesty, is the result of a superficial judgment, which assumes that the dishonest man is almost totally corrupt, an honest man almost entirely virtuous. In the light of a deeper knowledge and wider experience, such judgment is found to be erroneous. The dishonest man may have some admirable virtues which the other does not possess, and the honest man obnoxious vices which are absent in the other. The honest man reaps the good results of his honest thoughts and acts. He also brings upon himself the sufferings which his vices produce. The dishonest man likewise garners his own suffering and happiness. It is pleasing to human vanity to believe that one suffers because of one's virtue, but not until a man has extirpated every sickly, bitter, and impure thought from his soul can he be in a position to know and declare that his sufferings are the result of his good and not of his bad qualities. And on the way to, yet long before he has reached that supreme perfection, he will have found, working in his mind and life, the great law which is absolutely just, and which cannot, therefore, give good for evil, evil for good. Possessed of such knowledge, he will then know, looking back upon his past ignorance and blindness, that his life is, and always was, justly ordered, and that all his past experiences, good and bad, were the equitable outworking of his evolving, yet unevolved self. Okay, we will pause there. Let's cover this part. In this section, we explore the profound concept that man is the causer of his own circumstances, and the role of thoughts and actions in shaping one's life. Let's dive into its meaning, in simpler terms. The section presents various scenarios to illustrate the underlying truth that individuals are the creators of their own realities, often unconsciously. It highlights the detrimental consequences of harboring negative thoughts and engaging in unproductive behaviors. For instance, it discusses the case of a poor man who desires better surroundings but avoids work and resorts to deception. Such a mindset hinders his prosperity and attracts further misery. Similarly, a rich man plagued by an illness due to gluttony may seek remedies but refuses to let go of his unhealthy desires, preventing true healing. In another example, an employer who resorts to unethical practices ultimately faces bankruptcy and blames external circumstances instead of recognizing his own role in the situation. These cases serve as illustrations of how individuals, through their thoughts and desires, either align themselves with or hinder their desired outcomes. The section emphasizes that external circumstances alone cannot serve as a basis for understanding one's inner state. The complexities of circumstances, deeply rooted thoughts, and individual variations make it necessary to explore the inner workings of the mind and life to grasp the true causes and effects. It acknowledges that honesty or dishonesty in specific aspects does not solely determine an individual's success or suffering. Superficial judgments that attribute failure to honesty or prosperity to dishonesty oversimplify the complexities of human nature. The dishonest person may possess virtues that the honest one lacks, while the honest person may struggle with vices absent in the dishonest one. Each reaps the consequences of their thoughts and actions, experiencing both the fruits of their virtues and the sufferings caused by their vices. The section highlights the importance of self-reflection and self-purification in gaining deeper knowledge and understanding. It suggests that until a person has eradicated negative and impure thoughts from their being, they cannot accurately discern whether their sufferings arise from their virtues or vices. Only through the transformative journey of self-improvement can one realize the inherent justice of the great law at work. It is a law that ensures a fair exchange, granting good in response to good and responding to evil with its appropriate consequences. As individuals progress on this path of self-discovery, they come to realize the just order of their lives, understanding that all past experiences, both positive and negative, were manifestations of their evolving yet unevolved selves. In summary, this section emphasizes that individuals are the creators of their own circumstances through their thoughts and actions. It sheds light on the intricate interplay of causes and effects in life, urging self-reflection and the pursuit of virtuous thoughts and actions to manifest positive outcomes. By recognizing the profound impact of their own inner state, individuals can take charge of their lives, align themselves with higher principles, and gradually unfold their true potential. Let's continue. Good thoughts and actions can never produce bad results. Bad thoughts and actions can never produce good results. This is but saying that nothing can come from corn but corn, nothing from nettles but nettles. Men understand this law in the natural world, and work with it. But few understand it in the mental and moral world, though its operation there is just as simple and undeviating, and they, therefore, do not cooperate with it. Suffering is always the effect of wrong thought in some direction. It is an indication that the individual is out of harmony with himself, with the law of his being. The sole and supreme use of suffering is to purify, to burn out all that is useless and impure. Suffering ceases for him who is pure. There could be no object in burning gold after the dross had been removed, and a perfectly pure and enlightened being could not suffer. The circumstances which a man encounters with suffering are the result of his own mental inharmony. The circumstances which a man encounters with blessedness are the result of his own mental harmony. Blessedness, not material possessions, is the measure of right thought. Wretchedness, not lack of material possessions, is the measure of wrong thought. A man may be cursed and rich, he may be blessed and poor. Blessedness and riches are only joined together when the riches are rightly and wisely used. And the poor man only descends into wretchedness when he regards his lot as a burden unjustly imposed. Let's dive deeper into this section. Imagine that our thoughts are like magical seeds that we plant in our minds. Just like when we plant a seed in the ground, it grows into a specific plant or flower. Our thoughts also grow and create our experiences. When we have good thoughts, like being kind, helpful, and positive, good things happen to us. It's like planting seeds of happiness and joy. On the other hand, when we have bad thoughts, like being mean, selfish, or negative, bad things happen to us. It's like planting seeds of sadness and trouble. This is a law of nature that people understand when it comes to plants. We know that if we plant corn seeds, we will get corn plants. If we plant nettle seeds, we will get nettle plants. We work with this law in the natural world by choosing the right seeds to plant. But sometimes we forget that this same law applies to our thoughts and actions. Our thoughts create our experiences, just like seeds grow into plants. When we have negative thoughts, it can cause us to feel unhappy and face difficulties. It's like planting bad seeds that grow into weeds in our lives. Suffering is when we feel sad, hurt, or have a hard time. It happens when we have a lot of negative thoughts and are not in harmony with ourselves and the world around us. But suffering has a purpose. It helps us learn and grow. It's like a fire that burns away all the things that are not good for us, making us stronger and better. When we become pure and enlightened, which means having only good and positive thoughts, suffering disappears. It's like when gold is purified and all the impurities are removed, it shines brightly and doesn't get burned anymore. The experiences we have in life, whether good or bad, are a result of our thoughts. When we have positive thoughts, we attract positive experiences. When we have negative thoughts, we attract negative experiences. It's not about having lots of material possessions that makes us happy, but having the right thoughts and being in harmony with ourselves. Sometimes, a person may be rich but still feel cursed and unhappy because they have negative thoughts. And sometimes, a person may be poor but feel blessed and happy because they have positive thoughts. It's not about what we have, but how we think about what we have. So, remember, the thoughts we have shape our experiences. If we plant positive thoughts in our minds, we will grow happiness and joy. But if we plant negative thoughts, we will grow sadness and trouble. Let's continue with the book. Indigence and indulgence are the two extremes of wretchedness. They are both equally unnatural and the result of mental disorder. A man is not rightly conditioned until he is a happy, healthy, and prosperous being, and happiness, health, and prosperity are the result of a harmonious adjustment of the inner with the outer of the man with his surroundings. A man only begins to be a man when he ceases to whine and revile, and commences to search for the hidden justice which regulates his life. And he adapts his mind to that regulating factor, he ceases to accuse others as the cause of his condition, and builds himself up in strong and noble thoughts, ceases to kick against circumstances, but begins to use them as aids to his more rapid progress, and as a means of discovering the hidden powers and possibilities within himself. Law, not confusion, is the dominating principle in the universe. Justice, not injustice, is the soul and substance of life. Righteousness, not corruption, is the molding and moving force in the spiritual government of the world. This being so, man has but to right himself to find that the universe is right. And during the process of putting himself right, he will find that as he alters his thoughts towards things and other people will alter towards him. The proof of this truth is in every person, and it therefore admits of easy investigation by systematic introspection and self-analysis. Let a man radically alter his thoughts, and he will be astonished at the rapid transformation it will effect in the material conditions of his life. Men imagine that thought can be kept secret, but it cannot. It rapidly crystallizes into habit, and habit solidifies into circumstance. Bestial thoughts crystallize into habits of drunkenness and sensuality, which solidify into circumstances of destitution and disease. Impure thoughts of every kind crystallize into enervating and confusing habits, which solidify into distracting and adverse circumstances. Thoughts of fear, doubt, and indecision crystallize into weak, unmanly, and irresolute habits, which solidify into circumstances of failure, indigence, and slavish dependence. So, let's talk about this section now. There are two extremes of being unhappy and poor. One is when someone doesn't have enough and is very poor. The other is when someone has too much and becomes greedy. Both of these situations are not natural and can make a person feel wretched. A person is not in the right condition until they are happy, healthy, and prosperous. Happiness, health, and prosperity come when everything inside a person matches well with everything outside, like how puzzle pieces fit together. A person truly becomes a mature and responsible individual when they stop complaining and blaming others for their problems. Instead, they start looking for fairness and justice in their own life. They adjust their thoughts and attitudes to be positive and noble. They stop fighting against their circumstances and use them as opportunities for growth and discovering their own hidden abilities. The world operates on the principle of law and justice. It's not a chaotic or unfair place. When a person aligns themselves with righteousness and good values, they will see that the universe supports them. As they change their thoughts about things and people, they will notice that things and people change in response to them. You can see the proof of this truth in your own life by looking closely. If you make a big change in your thoughts, you will be amazed at how quickly your life starts to transform. Thoughts have a way of becoming habits, and habits shape your circumstances. If you have bad thoughts, like being mean or selfish, they can turn into habits of drinking or being unhealthy, which can lead to poverty and sickness. If you have impure thoughts or thoughts of fear and doubt, they can become habits that make you confused and weak, leading to failure and dependence on others. So, it's important to have good thoughts and be kind, generous, and confident. When you have positive thoughts, they will turn into good habits, and good habits will create a happy and prosperous life. Remember, what you think becomes who you are, and your thoughts can shape your circumstances. Choose your thoughts wisely. Let's continue. Lazy thoughts crystallize into weak habits of uncleanliness and dishonesty, which solidify into circumstances of foulness and beggary. Hateful and condemnatory thoughts crystallize into habits of accusation and violence, which solidify into circumstances of injury and persecution. Selfish thoughts of all kinds crystallize into habits of self-seeking, which solidify into distressful circumstances. On the other hand, beautiful thoughts of all kinds crystallize into habits of grace and kindliness, which solidify into genial and sunny circumstances. Pure thoughts crystallize into habits of temperance and self-control, which solidify into circumstances of repose and peace. Thoughts of courage, self-reliance, and decision crystallize into manly habits, which solidify into circumstances of success, plenty, and freedom. Energetic thoughts crystallize into habits of cleanliness and industry, which solidify into circumstances of pleasantness. Gentle and forgiving thoughts crystallize into habits of gentleness, which solidify into protective and preservative circumstances. Loving and unselfish thoughts which solidify into circumstances of sure and abiding prosperity and true riches. A particular train of thought persisted in, be it good or bad, cannot fail to produce its results on the character and circumstances. A man cannot directly choose his circumstances, but he can choose his thoughts, and so indirectly, yet surely, shape his circumstances. Nature helps every man to gratification of the thoughts which he most encourages, and opportunities are presented which will most speedily bring to the surface both the good and the evil thoughts. Let a man cease from his sinful thoughts, and all the world will soften towards him, and be ready to help him. Let him put away his weakly and sickly thoughts, and the opportunities will spring up on every hand to aid his strong resolves. Let him encourage good thoughts, and no hard fate shall bind him down to wretchedness and shame. The world is your kaleidoscope, and the varying combinations of colors which at every succeeding moment it presents to you are the exquisitely adjusted pictures of your ever-moving thoughts. You will be what you will to be. Let failure find its false content in that poor word. Environment. But spirit scorns it, and is free. It masters time, it conquers space, it cows that boastful trickster, chance, and bids the tyrant circumstance uncrown, and fill a servant's place. The human will, that force unseen, the offspring of deathless soul, can hew a way to any goal, though walls of granite intervene. Be not impatient in delay, but wait as one who understands. When spirit rises and commands, the gods are ready to obey. Now, let's go over this section. Lazy thoughts are like being lazy and not wanting to do anything. They can turn into bad habits like not cleaning up or being dishonest, which can lead to a smelly and poor life. Mean thoughts, like saying mean things or being angry at others, can turn into habits of being mean and violent, which can make people treat you badly. Selfish thoughts, like always wanting things for yourself, can lead to difficult situations where you don't have enough. On the other hand, beautiful thoughts are like thinking nice things about others and being kind. They can turn into good habits of being helpful and friendly, which can make your life pleasant and joyful. Pure thoughts, like being clean and in control of yourself, can lead to a peaceful and calm life. Brave thoughts, like being brave and confident, can turn into habits of success and freedom. Energetic thoughts, like being active and hardworking, can make your life enjoyable. Gentle thoughts, like being gentle and forgiving, can create a safe and protected life. Loving and unselfish thoughts can bring true prosperity and riches. The thoughts we have, whether good or bad, have a powerful effect on our character and the circumstances we face. We may not be able to directly choose our circumstances, but we can choose our thoughts. By choosing positive and good thoughts, we can shape our circumstances in a positive way. Nature helps us by bringing opportunities that match our thoughts. If we let go of sinful thoughts and choose better ones, the world will become kinder and more supportive. If we stop thinking weak and sickly thoughts and become strong in our minds, opportunities will come to help us. When we encourage good thoughts, we can avoid a miserable and shameful life. Think of the world as a kaleidoscope, a special toy that shows beautiful patterns by changing colors. The world reflects the thoughts we have. If we think positively, our life will be filled with wonderful colors and experiences. Remember, you have the power to be who you want to be. Don't blame your environment for your failures. Your spirit is strong and can overcome any obstacles. Trust in yourself, be patient, and when you believe in your dreams, the universe will support you. You are in control of your thoughts, and with a positive attitude, you can achieve anything you set your mind to. Let's continue with our reading. The next chapter is shorter, so we'll cover the entire chapter in one go. Effects of thoughts on health and body. The body is the servant of the mind. It obeys the operations of the mind, whether they be deliberately chosen or automatically expressed. At the bidding of unlawful thoughts, the body sinks rapidly into disease and decay, at the command of glad and beautiful thoughts, it becomes clothed with youthfulness and beauty. Disease and health, like circumstances, are rooted in thought. Sickly thoughts will express themselves through a sickly body. Thoughts of fear have been known to kill a man as speedily as a bullet, and they are continually killing thousands of people just as surely, though less rapidly. The people who live in fear of disease are the people who get it. Anxiety quickly demoralizes the whole body and lays it open to the entrance of disease, while impure thoughts, even if not physically indulged, will sooner shatter the nervous system. Strong, pure, and happy thoughts build up the body in vigor and grace. The body is a delicate and plastic instrument, which responds readily to the thoughts by which it is impressed, and habits of thought will produce their own effects, good or bad, upon it. Men will continue to have impure and poisoned blood, so long as they propagate unclean thoughts. Out of a clean heart comes a clean life and a clean body. Out of a defiled mind proceeds a defiled life and a corrupt body. Thought is the fount of action, life and manifestation. Make the fountain pure, and all will be pure. Change of diet will not help a man who will not change his thoughts. When a man makes his thoughts pure, he no longer desires impure food. Clean thoughts make clean habits. The so-called saint who does not wash his body is not a saint. He who has strengthened and purified his thoughts does not need to consider the malevolent. If you would perfect your body, guard your mind. If you would renew your body, beautify your mind. Thoughts of malice, envy, and disappointment, despondency, rob the body of its health and grace. A sour face does not come by chance. It is made by sour thoughts. Wrinkles that mar are drawn by folly, passion, pride. I know a woman of 96 who has the bright, innocent face of a girl. I know a man well under middle age whose face is drawn into inharmonious contours. The one is the result of a sweet and sunny disposition. The other is the outcome of passion and discontent. As you cannot have a sweet and wholesome abode unless you admit the air and sunshine freely into your rooms, so a strong body and a bright, happy, or serene countenance can only result from the free admittance into the mind of thoughts of joy and goodwill and serenity. On the faces of the aged there are wrinkles made by sympathy, others by strong and pure thought, and others are carved by passion, who cannot distinguish them. With those who have lived righteously, age is calm, peaceful, and softly mellowed, like the setting sun. I have recently seen a philosopher on his deathbed. He was not old except in years. He died as sweetly and peacefully as he had lived. There is no physician like cheerful thought for dissipating the ills of the body. There is no comforter to compare with goodwill for dispersing the shadows of grief and sorrow. To live continually in thoughts of ill will, cynicism, suspicion, and envy is to be confined in a self-made prison hole. But to think well of all, to be cheerful with all, to patiently learn to find the good in all, such unselfish thoughts are the very portals of heaven, and to dwell day by day in thoughts of peace toward every creature will bring abounding peace to their possessor. That's the end of that section. Let's go over what this means. Our body listens to our mind. If we think happy and positive thoughts, our body becomes healthy and strong. But if we have sad or negative thoughts, our body can become sick and weak. Just like how our body gets sick when we're scared or worried, our thoughts can make us unhealthy. When we think good thoughts and take care of our mind, our body becomes full of energy and looks beautiful. Our body is like a special instrument that can change depending on our thoughts. If we think strong and happy thoughts, our body becomes strong and graceful. But if we think bad and impure thoughts, it can harm our body and make us feel bad. The kind of thoughts we have affects our body and how we feel. If we have clean and pure thoughts, it makes our body clean and healthy. But if our thoughts are mean or unkind, it can make our body sick. Our thoughts are like a fountain that creates our actions and our life. When our thoughts are pure, everything about us becomes pure. Changing our diet or food won't make us healthy if we don't change our thoughts. When we have pure thoughts, we naturally want to eat healthy food. Clean thoughts lead to clean habits. Someone who claims to be good but doesn't take care of their body is not truly good. When we have pure and positive thoughts, our body becomes renewed and beautiful. Our face shows the effects of our thoughts. If we have happy and kind thoughts, our face looks bright and innocent, like a young child. But if we have angry or unhappy thoughts, it can show on our face with wrinkles and unhappy expressions. The way we think affects the way we look. To have a healthy body and a happy face, we need to let good thoughts into our mind. Just like we need fresh air and sunlight in our home, we need thoughts of joy, kindness, and peace in our mind. People who have lived a good life and thought good thoughts have a calm and peaceful old age. I knew a wise person who passed away peacefully because he had a kind and peaceful mind. Having positive thoughts is like having a doctor who can make our body feel better. And having goodwill, which means being kind and friendly to everyone, can make our sadness go away. But if we always think mean and negative thoughts, it's like being stuck in a dark and lonely prison. Instead, let's think well of others, be happy with everyone, and find good things in everything. These unselfish thoughts can bring us peace and happiness. Okay, so let's continue. Next chapter is short as well, so we will cover the entire chapter and then go into its explanation. Thought and purpose. Until thought is linked with purpose, there is no intelligent accomplishment. With the majority, the bark of thought is allowed to drift upon the ocean of life. Aimlessness is a vice, and such drifting must not continue for him who would steer clear of catastrophe and destruction. They who have no central purpose in their life fall an easy prey to petty worries, fears, troubles, and self-pityings, all of which are indications of weakness, which lead, just as surely as deliberately planned sins, though by a diff route, to failure, unhappiness, and loss, for weakness cannot persist in a power-evolving universe. A man should conceive of a legitimate purpose in his heart and set out to accomplish it. He should make this purpose the centralizing point of his thoughts. It may take the form of a spiritual ideal, or it may be a worldly object, according to his nature at the time being. Whichever it is, he should steadily focus his thought forces upon the object he had set before him. He should make this purpose his supreme duty and should devote himself to its attainment, not allowing his thoughts to wander away into ephemeral fancies, longings, and imaginings. This is the royal road to self-control and true concentration of thought. Even if he fails again and again to accomplish his purpose, as he must until weakness is overcome, the strength of character gained will be the measure of his true success, and this will form a new starting point for future power and triumph. Those who are not prepared for the apprehension of a great purpose should fix the thoughts upon the faultless performance of their duty, no matter how insignificant their task may appear. Only in this way can the thoughts be gathered and focused, and resolution and energy be developed. Once this is done, there is nothing which may not be accomplished. The weakest soul, knowing its own weakness, and believing this truth, that strength can only be developed by effort and practice, will, thus believing, at once begin to exert itself. And adding effort to effort, patience to patience, and strength to strength, will never cease to develop and will at last grow divinely strong. As the physically weak man can make himself strong by careful and patient training, so the man of weak thoughts can make them strong by exercising himself in right thinking. To put away aimlessness and weakness and to begin to think with purpose is to enter the ranks of those strong ones who only recognize failure as one of the pathways to attainment, who make all conditions serve them, and who think strongly, attempt fearlessly, and accomplish masterfully. Having conceived of his purpose, a man should mentally mark out a straight pathway to its achievement, looking neither to the right nor left. Doubts and fears should be rigorously excluded. They are disintegrating elements which break up the straight line of effort, rendering it crooked, ineffectual, useless. Thoughts of doubt and fear can never accomplish anything. They always lead to failure. Purpose, energy, power to do, and all strong thoughts cease when doubt and fear creep in. The will to do springs from the knowledge that we can do. Doubt and fear are the great enemies of knowledge, and he who encourages them, who does not slay them, thwarts himself at every step. He who has conquered doubt and fear has conquered failure. His every thought is allied with power, and all difficulties are bravely met and overcome. His purposes are seasonably planted, and they bloom and bring forth fruit that does not fall prematurely to the ground. thought allied fearlessly to purpose becomes creative force. He who knows this is ready to become something higher and stronger than a bundle of wavering thoughts and fluctuating sensations. He who does this has become the conscious and intelligent wielder of his mental powers. Our thoughts become powerful when we have a purpose. If we just let our thoughts wander aimlessly without a goal, we won't achieve anything important. It's like sailing a boat without knowing where we want to go. That's not good because it can lead to trouble and unhappiness. People who don't have a clear purpose in life easily get worried, scared, and feel sorry for themselves. These feelings show that they are weak and can lead to failure and loss. Weakness can't exist in a world that is always growing and evolving. To be successful, a person needs to think about what they want to achieve. They should focus their thoughts on that goal and make it the most important thing in their mind. It could be something spiritual or something they want to do in the world. They should keep thinking about it and not let their thoughts get distracted by unimportant things. This helps them have self-control and concentrate on what matters. Even if they fail many times, the strength they gain from trying will lead to future success. If someone is not ready for a big purpose yet, they can focus on doing their duties well, no matter how small they seem. By doing their best and staying focused, they gather their thoughts and become determined and full of energy. Once they do that, there's nothing they can't accomplish. Even the weakest person, who knows they are weak, can become strong by believing in themselves and making an effort. They keep trying, being patient and strong, and they never stop growing. It's like when someone exercises to make their body stronger. In the same way, a person can make their thoughts stronger by thinking in the right way. They need to get rid of aimlessness and weakness and start thinking with a purpose. This puts them among the strong people who see failure as a way to succeed. They use all situations to their advantage and think strongly, try fearlessly, and accomplish great things. When someone has a purpose, they need to imagine a straight path to achieving it. They shouldn't let doubts and fears get in their way. Doubts and fears make efforts crooked and ineffective. Thoughts of doubt and fear never lead to success. But when someone believes in themselves and gets rid of doubts and fears, they conquer failure. Their thoughts are full of power, and they bravely overcome any difficulties. Their goals are set at the right time, and they achieve great things that last. When fearless thoughts are connected to a purpose, they become a creative force. The person who knows this becomes something better than just a bundle of uncertain thoughts and feelings. They become aware of their mental powers and can use them wisely. Let's continue to next chapter now. The thought factor in achievement. All that a man achieves and all that he fails to achieve is the direct result of his own thoughts. In a justly ordered universe, where loss of equipoise would mean total destruction, individual responsibility must be absolute. A man's weakness and strength, purity and impurity, are his own and not another man's. They are brought about by himself and not by another, and they can only be altered by himself, never by another. His condition is also his own and not another man's. His sufferings and his happiness are evolved from within. As he thinks, so is he. As he continues to think, so he remains. A strong man cannot help a weaker unless that weaker is willing to be helped. And even then the weak man must become strong of himself. He must, by his own efforts, develop the strength which he admires in another. None but himself can alter his condition. It has been usual for men to think and to say, "Many men are slaves because one is an oppressor. Let us hate the oppressor." But there is amongst an increasing few a tendency to reverse this judgment and to say, "One man is an oppressor because many are slaves. Let us despise the slaves." The truth is that oppressor and slaves are cooperators in ignorance, and while seeming to afflict each other, are in reality afflicting themselves. A perfect knowledge perceives the action of law in the weakness of the oppressed and the misapplied power of the oppressor. A perfect love, seeing the suffering which both states entail, condemns either. A perfect compassion embraces both oppressor and oppressed. He who has conquered weakness and has pushed away all selfish thoughts belongs neither to oppressor nor oppressed. He is free. A man can only rise, conquer, and achieve by lifting up his thoughts. He can only remain weak, abject, and miserably by refusing to lift up his thoughts. Before a man can achieve anything, even in worldly things, he must lift his thoughts above slavish animal indulgence. He may not, in order to succeed, give up all animality and selfishness, necessarily, but a portion of it must, at least, be sacrificed. A man whose first thought is bestial indulgence could neither think clearly nor plan methodically. He could not find and develop his latent resources and would fail in any undertaking. Not having begun to manfully control his thoughts, he is not in a position to control affairs and to adopt serious responsibilities. He is not fit to act independently and stand alone. But he is limited only by the thoughts that he chooses. There can be no progress nor achievement without sacrifice, and a man's worldly success will be by the measure that he sacrifices his confused animal thoughts and fixes his mind on the development of his plans and the strengthening of his resolution and self-reliance. The higher he lifts his thoughts, the greater will be his success, the more blessed and enduring will be his achievements. The universe does not favor the greedy, the dishonest, the vicious, although on the mere surface it sometimes may appear to do so. It helps the honest, the magnanimous, the virtuous. All the great teachers of the ages have declared this in varying ways, and to prove it and to know it, a man has but to persist in making himself increasingly virtuous by lifting his thoughts. Intellectual achievements are the result of thought consecrated to the search for knowledge or for the beautiful and true in nature. Such achievements may sometimes be connected with vanity and ambition, but they are not the outcome of those characteristics. They are the natural outgrowth of long and arduous effort, and of pure and unselfish thoughts. Spiritual achievements are the consummation of holy aspirations. He who lives constantly in the conception of noble and lofty thoughts, who dwells upon all that is pure and selfless, will, as surely as the sun reaches its zenith and the moon its full, become wise and noble in character and rise into a position of influence and blessedness. Achievement of any kind is the crown of effort, the diadem of thought. By the aid of self-control, resolution, purity, righteousness, and well-directed thought, a man ascends. By the aid of animality, indolence, impurity, corruption, and confusion of thought, a man descends. A man may rise to high success in the world, even to lofty attitudes in the spiritual realm, and again descend into weakness and wretchedness by allowing arrogant, selfish, and corrupt thoughts to take possession of him. Victories attained by right thought can be maintained only by watchfulness. Many give way when success is assured, and rapidly fall back into failure. All achievements, whether in the business, intellectual, or spiritual world, are the result of definitely directed thought. They are governed by the same law, and are of the same method. The only difference lies in the object of attainment. He who would accomplish little needs sacrifice little. He who would achieve much must sacrifice much. He who would attain highly must sacrifice greatly. So, let's go into this chapter's explanation. This chapter emphasizes the power of thoughts and their influence on our lives. It suggests that our achievements and failures are directly linked to our thoughts. If we want to accomplish something meaningful, we need to have a clear purpose and align our thoughts with that purpose. The passage highlights the importance of having a central purpose in life. Aimlessness and drifting through life without a clear direction are seen as detrimental. Without a purpose, we become susceptible to worries, fears, and troubles, which ultimately lead to failure and unhappiness. The passage argues that weakness cannot persist in a universe that is evolving towards higher states of power and consciousness. To achieve success, the text suggests that we need to conceive a legitimate purpose and make it the focal point of our thoughts. This purpose can be spiritual or worldly, depending on our nature and values. By focusing our thoughts on our purpose and avoiding distractions and fleeting desires, we develop self-control, concentration, and determination. Even if we face failures along the way, the strength of character we gain becomes a measure of our true success. This section also emphasizes the importance of personal responsibility. It suggests that external circumstances or other people cannot determine our destiny. We have the power to alter our own conditions through our thoughts and actions. By taking responsibility for our thoughts, we can shape our lives and achieve great things. Moreover, it challenges the notion of blaming oppressors for the state of the oppressed. It suggests that both the oppressor and the oppressed are cooperating in their ignorance. True knowledge and compassion recognize the suffering caused by both states and seek to uplift and free both parties. It implies that the path to freedom lies in overcoming weakness, selfishness, and hatred. The text also highlights the relationship between thought and achievement. It emphasizes that achievements, whether intellectual, spiritual, or worldly, are the direct result of focused and directed thought. By disciplining our thoughts and aligning them with noble ideals, we can attain success, wisdom, and influence. However, maintaining these achievements requires ongoing vigilance and avoiding complacency. In summary, this chapter teaches us that our thoughts shape our reality and determine our achievements. By linking our thoughts with purpose, taking personal responsibility, and cultivating noble and focused thinking, we can achieve success, happiness, and spiritual growth. It encourages us to be aware of our thoughts, make conscious choices, and strive for self-mastery. Let's continue to the next section. Visions and ideals. The dreamers are the saviors of the world. As the visible world is sustained by the invisible, so men, through all their trials and sins and sordid vocations, are nourished by the beautiful visions of their solitary dreamers. Humanity cannot forget its dreamers. It cannot let their ideals fade and die. It lives in them. It knows them as the realities which it shall one day see and know. Composer, sculptor, painter, poet, prophet, sage, these are the makers of the afterworld, the architects of heaven. The world is beautiful because they have lived. Without them, laboring humanity would perish. He who cherishes a beautiful vision, a lofty ideal in his heart, will one day realize it. Columbus cherished a vision of another world and he discovered it. Copernicus fostered the vision of a multiplicity of worlds and a wider universe, and he revealed it. Buddha beheld the vision of a spiritual world of stainless beauty and perfect peace, and he entered into it. Cherish your visions, cherish your ideals. Cherish the music that stirs in your heart, the beauty that forms in your mind, the loveliness that drapes your purest thoughts. For out of them will grow all delightful conditions, all heavenly environment. Of these, if you but remain true to them, your world will at last be built. To desire is to obtain, to aspire is to achieve. Shall man's basest desires receive the fullest measure of gratification, and his purest aspirations starve for lack of sustenance? Such is not the law. Such a condition can never obtain. Ask and receive. Dream lofty dreams, and as you dream, so shall you become. Your vision is the promise of what you shall one day be. Your ideal is the prophecy of what you shall at last unveil. The greatest achievement was at first and for a time a dream. The oak sleeps in the acorn, the bird waits in the egg. And in the highest vision of a soul a waking angle stirs. Dreams are the seedlings of realities. Your circumstances may be uncongenial, but they shall not remain so if you only perceive an ideal and strive to reach it. You cannot travel within and stand still without. Here is a youth hard-pressed by poverty and labor. Confined long hours in an unhealthy workshop, unschooled and lacking all the arts of refinement. But he dreams of better things. He thinks of intelligence, or refinement, of grace and beauty. He conceives of, mentally builds up, an ideal condition of life. The wider liberty and a larger scope takes possession of him. Unrest urges him to action, and he uses all his spare times and means to the development of his latent powers and resources. Very soon so altered has his mind become that the workshop can no longer hold him. It has become so out of harmony with his mindset that it falls out of his life as a garment is cast aside. And with the growth of opportunities that fit the scope of his expanding powers, he passes out of it altogether. Years later we see this youth as a grown man. We find him a master of certain forces of the mind that he wields with worldwide influence and almost unequaled power. In his hands he holds the cords of gigantic responsibilities. He speaks and lives are changed. Men and women hang upon his words and remold their characters. Sun-like, he becomes the fixed and luminous center around which innumerable destinies revolve. He has realized the vision of his youth. He has become one with his ideal. And you, too, will realize the vision, not just the idle wish, of your heart, be it base or beautiful, or a mixture of both, for you will always gravitate toward that which you secretly love most. Into your hands will be placed the exact results of your own thoughts. You will receive that which you earn, no more, no less. Whatever your present environment may be, you will fall, remain, or rise with your thoughts, your vision, your ideal. You will become as small as your controlling desire, as great as your dominant aspiration. The thoughtless, the ignorant, and the indolent, seeing only the apparent effects of things and not the things themselves, talk of luck, of fortune, and chance. Seeing a man grow rich, they say, "How lucky he is!" Observing another become skilled intellectually, they exclaim, "How highly favored he is!" And noting the saintly character and wide influence of another, they remark, "How chance helps him at every turn!" They do not see the trials and failures and struggles which these men have encountered in order to gain their experience. They have no knowledge of the sacrifices they have made, of the undaunted efforts they have put forth, of the faith they have exercised so that they might overcome the apparently insurmountable and realize the vision of their heart. They do not know the darkness and the heartaches. They only see the light and joy, and call it luck. Do not see the long, arduous journey, but only behold the pleasant goal and call it good fortune. Do not understand the process, but only perceive the result and call it chance. In all human affairs there are efforts, and there are results. The strength of the effort is the measure of the result. Change is not. Gifts, powers, material, intellectual, and spiritual possessions are the fruits of effort. They are thoughts completed, objectives accomplished, visions realized. The vision that you glorify in your mind, the ideal that you enthrone in your heart, this you will build your life by. This you will become. This chapter explores the significance of visions and ideals in shaping our lives. It suggests that dreamers, those who hold beautiful visions and lofty ideals, are the saviors of the world. Their visions nourish and sustain humanity, and without them, humanity would perish. The passage recognizes the essential role of composers, sculptors, painters, poets, prophets, and sages as the creators of a better world, as they bring beauty, inspiration, and wisdom into existence. The text emphasizes that those who cherish and nurture their visions and ideals will eventually realize them. It presents historical examples such as Columbus, who dreamed of discovering a new world, and Buddha, who envisioned a spiritual realm of peace and beauty. By remaining true to their visions, these individuals manifested their dreams into reality. It encourages readers to cherish their own visions, whether they are musical, artistic, or pure thoughts of goodness and beauty. It suggests that these visions, if held firmly and pursued faithfully, will create delightful conditions and a heavenly environment in one's life. The passage challenges the idea that baser desires are more readily fulfilled than noble aspirations. It asserts that the law of attainment operates on the principle of ask and receive. To achieve one's dreams, one must aspire and work towards them. The text encourages readers to dream lofty dreams because those dreams are the promise of what they will become. It emphasizes that great achievements always begin as dreams, just as an oak tree sleeps within an acorn and a bird waits within an egg. Dreams are the seedlings of realities, and through focused effort and unwavering dedication, dreams can be transformed into tangible achievements. It acknowledges that one's circumstances may initially be unfavorable, but it asserts that through perceiving and pursuing an ideal, one can transform those circumstances. The text presents the example of a youth trapped in poverty and a laborious environment. Despite the challenges, the youth dreams of a better life, cultivates intelligence, refinement, and grace in his thoughts, and takes action to develop his latent powers and resources. Over time, his mind becomes incompatible with his previous circumstances, and he transcends his limitations to become a person of influence and power. Furthermore, there's emphasis that individuals are responsible for their own thoughts and their corresponding results. It dismisses the notion of luck or chance as explanations for success or failure. It highlights the unseen trials, sacrifices, and struggles that individuals go through to realize their visions. It cautions against superficial judgments based solely on the apparent results, urging readers to recognize the effort and perseverance behind those achievements. In conclusion, this chapter underscores the transformative power of visions and ideals. It emphasizes the importance of cherishing and nurturing these visions, as they serve as guiding lights in our lives. By aligning our thoughts and actions with our ideals, we have the potential to shape our destinies and become the embodiment of our dreams. It encourages readers to understand that effort and perseverance are the keys to manifesting their visions and achieving their goals. Let's continue to the last section. Serenity. Calmness of mind is one of the beautiful jewels of wisdom. It is the result of long and patient effort and self-control. Its presence is an indication of ripened experience, and of a more than ordinary knowledge of the laws and operations of thought. A man becomes calm in the measure that he understands himself as a thought-evolved being. For such knowledge necessitates the understanding of others as the result of thought, and as he develops a right understanding, and sees ever more clearly the internal relations of things by the action of cause and effect, he ceases to fuss, fume, worry, and grieve. He remains poised, steadfast, serene. The calm man, having learned how to govern himself, knows how to adapt himself to others. And they, in turn, reverence his spiritual strength. They feel that they can learn from him and rely upon him. The more tranquil a man becomes, the greater is his success, his influence, his power for good. Even the ordinary trader will find his business prosperity increase as he develops a greater self-control and equanimity, for people will always prefer to deal with a man whose demeanor is equitable. The strong, calm man is always loved and revered. He is like a shade-giving tree in a thirsty land, or a sheltering rock in a storm. Who does not love a tranquil heart, a sweet-tempered, balanced life? It does not matter whether it rains or shines, or what changes come to those who possess these blessings, for they are always serene and calm. That exquisite poise of character that we call serenity is the last lesson of culture. It is the flowering of life, the fruitage of the soul. It is precious as wisdom, more desirable than fine gold. How insignificant mere money-seeking looks in comparison with a serene life. A life that dwells in the ocean of truth, beneath the waves, beyond the reach of the tempests, in the eternal calm. How many people we know who sour their lives, who ruin all that is sweet and beautiful by explosive tempers, who destroy their poise of character and make bad blood. It is a question whether the great majority of people do not ruin their lives and mar their happiness by lack of self-control. How few people we meet in life who are well-balanced, who have that exquisite poise which is characteristic of the finished character. Yes, humanity surges with uncontrolled passion, is tumultuous with ungoverned grief, is blown about by anxiety and doubt. Only the wise man, only he whose thoughts are controlled and purified, makes the winds and the storms of the soul obey him. Tempest-tossed souls, wherever you may be, under whatever conditions you may live, know this. In the ocean of life the isles of blessedness are smiling and the sunny shore of your ideal awaits your coming. Keep your hands firmly upon the helm of thought. In the core of your soul reclines the commanding master. He does but sleep. Wake him. Self-control is strength. Right thought is mastery. Calmness is power. Say unto your heart, peace. Be still. That's the end of the book. Let's go over this last section. This insightful exploration revolves around the theme of serenity and the profound impact it can have on an individual's life. It underscores the significance of maintaining a calm mind and attributes it to a culmination of self-control and wisdom acquired through experience. By understanding oneself as a thought-evolved being, one can cultivate a serene disposition that remains steadfast and poised even in the face of challenges. A calm person possesses the ability to adapt to others, earning their reverence and trust. This inner tranquility not only enhances personal well-being but also contributes to greater success and influence in the world. The calm individual is likened to a shade-giving tree in a thirsty land or a sheltering rock in a storm, radiating a magnetic aura that draws people towards them. Moreover, the chapter delves into the contrast between those who lack self-control and allow their emotions to dominate their lives. It suggests that many individuals undermine their happiness and potential by failing to cultivate balance and composure. In contrast, those who prioritize self-mastery and exhibit serenity amidst life's trials are viewed as the true beneficiaries of wisdom. It encourages individuals to nurture their visions and ideals, recognizing their power to shape their lives. It asserts that dreams and aspirations, when cherished and pursued with unwavering determination, hold the potential to manifest in reality. The process of actualizing these visions may require effort and sacrifice, but the rewards far outweigh the challenges. Throughout the text, the chapter highlights the transformative nature of serenity, affirming its status as the ultimate goal of personal growth. It asserts that a serene life, rooted in truth and inner calm, holds greater value than material wealth or superficial achievements. By exercising self-control and directing their thoughts towards peace and stillness, individuals can unlock their true potential and navigate life's journey with grace and wisdom. As we reach the culmination of this profound journey through the pages of As a Man Thinketh, we are reminded of the power we hold within ourselves. The message resounding throughout this audiobook is clear: our thoughts shape our reality, and by harnessing the immense potential of our minds, we can create a life of purpose, abundance, and fulfillment. Let these words echo in your consciousness, igniting a spark of inspiration that will propel you forward on your path of personal growth. Embrace the wisdom of self-control, for it is the key to unlocking the doors of serenity and success. Nurture your visions and ideals, knowing that they have the capacity to manifest in your life when fueled by unwavering belief and dedicated action. Remember, you are the architect of your destiny, the master of your thoughts. Rise above the chaos and noise of the world, and cultivate a serene mind that radiates strength and resilience. With each passing moment, strive to align your thoughts with the highest truths and noblest aspirations, for it is in this alignment that you will find the true essence of who you are and what you can become. Let the transformative message of As a Man Thinketh resonate within you. Carry its teachings with you on your journey, allowing them to guide you through the challenges and triumphs that lie ahead. Embrace the boundless potential that resides within your mind, and let it shape the world around you. May your thoughts be a source of light in the darkest of times, a beacon of hope and possibility. As you step forward with purpose and determination, may you inspire others to unleash their own inner power. Remember, you have the ability to create a life of extraordinary beauty, joy, and abundance. Go forth, manifest your dreams, and become the master of your own destiny. The power is within you. Believe, act, and create the life you envision. The world awaits your greatness.